You know, if I had to pick something for OG to show me.
And you are already one game up, so this is the game to do it in.
You know, I don't know.
In any form of playoff, though, you don't really get to the point where you want to, you know, let's bring something new, something exciting.
Oh, come
every
on.
Game, no,
don't spoil our hopes, Waga. Please.
I'm spoiling Achiever because this is not a group stage.
I know.
All right, let's talk about these bans. As you said, Waga, you didn't see them changing their ban strat at all. It's gonna be a void. It might be another
both
enigma.
I think both are gonna be. I think
exactly
even Beastmaster.
Yeah.
Oh, they go for the Phoenix.
No, I mean, what is it? No Diggity have the first pick, and they might want to get that BM for themselves.
Well, they can't handle that beam.
Yeah, that's sick, Immortal. I was looking at the Immortal pick. I was like,
that was
a
little straight
bit
up
like a
Dragon Ball Z Piccolo.
Yeah, that was the
beam right there.
But there's a Sonic Wave in there too, somewhere.
Huh?
The Sonic Wave emotion. Yeah, Sonic Wave's in there somewhere.
Okay, thanks, Sheev.
Yeah, you're welcome. Glad to be able to add to this discussion. Let's look at the game. Let's look at the draft. So we're going to probably see Enigma ban.
No, it's
maybe,
all good.
Maybe OG are like, you know what? Let them have the
Enigma. Beastmaster. They could ban Beastmaster instead if they want to, because that's also a hero that No Diggity play a lot.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, Waga calls it. All right, show me the Enigma. Come
on. Would you have first pick Enigma? Come on.
Come on, yes. You're comfortable with the hero.
If they don't take it, OG might. I mean, Crit plays a really good dire side jungling Enigma.
Damn, the knowledge.
And Fly is also a very notorious Enigma player. So I think Crit would be the one playing it here, but just having two players that are really great at it.
Or they get an early Oracle grab. That'd be great.
Sick.
Fly plays that as well.
Yeah, Oracle against Darkseer is really sweet, actually.
That's my copypasta right there.
OG is also the Crystal Maiden pickers.
What?
OG are also the Crystal Maiden pickers against Darkseer.
That's right. But yeah, you either ban Enigma or you pick Enigma when you're against No Diggity. So I think you guys are right. I think we're going to see an Enigma pick.
During Epicenter, by the way, Fly, I believe at some point, had only played either Phoenix or Dazzle.
That seems to be
there
his
were like
trend.
8 games, and he like had played 5 Phoenixes and 3 Dazzles.
I think that's how he like approaches these tournaments. He gets the 2 he's gonna lock onto. I remember like Frankfurt, it was like a lot of Undying.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It'll just like I'll stick with this.
Oh,
but
there
Doom,
we go. A Doom.
Can't
pick.
Forget the Doom.
Well, we can't forget Doom. I think Doom was ignored previous game.
Yeah,
so that's true.
Did forget it that game.
So why pick Doom in this one? Or what are they hoping to achieve here? Usually, when I see an early Doom pick, it means okay, we want to make sure that they don't pick too many super flashy heroes. We want to kind of control them.
I mean, Doom is just one of those heroes where he can farm up and he's always going to contribute a ton in fights. But you also have the ability against something like Darkseer. Darkseer is a great hero to just say, screw you, and you're not going to do your vacuum. The enemy team might rely heavily on the Darkseer in a combo. So if Doom gets a good initiation, you basically won the fight.
It also provides, you know, some versatility at the start. We don't know for sure if it's going to be offlane or a crit roaming. Yeah, they picked up the Earth Spirit now, but Fly's played Earth Spirit too. It, you know, you really don't know if it's going to be as clear cut or not. So you have that flexibility to work with when you do commit too early. Other heroes that I think was also possibly ignored last game was Nature's Prophet.
No, he did get banned out.
He did get banned out? Okay.
But it was the last ban, though. He made it through the entire pick phase.
Okay.
So.
Well, Nature's Prophet is not so easy to make, you know, that much happen with unless you can really control laning phase, though. Because later on, he suffers from enemies that just run at you. He really does. Mm-hmm. And the current patch, I mean, look at the heroes we're seeing. Earth Spirit, Doom, Nightstalker. It's hard to be a Nature's Prophet in games like these. You just get run at.
So why do No Diggity continue to go back for this Nightstalker
every
time? Mass control
thinking,
is great to have, but...
I don't think I've ever seen No Diggity win a Nightstalker game. No,
that's not
they've
true.
They've won a few, but it seems to be their comfort pick, but I haven't seen it do too much.
The lane wasn't too bad previous game, but it didn't do enough. It depends on what they have in plan for the rest of the game. And the vision is, of course, great later on, but you have to get to that stage before.
Right.
The main question is here... You saw how long OG debated if they were going to ban out the Beastmaster or if they were going to ban out potentially Enigma.
Yeah.
It took a while. So you'd imagine then that maybe OG is not super comfortable at playing against Enigma. Perhaps. This is a Yapzor Nightstalker, right?
I don't think... Well, the thing is, Cinderin can definitely play Nightstalker.
Yes.
He's famous for that hero as well. So they could go for Enigma still.
It's very good.
And OG might just think, hey, let's not get rid of the Enigma here. But I think if Enigma gets let through all the way, No Diggity will definitely pick it up somewhere along the line.
I'm not sure. Maybe they just want to say, you know what, we can play different. We can switch it up. We're going to prove it by not picking our comfort hero right now.
I would not do that.
They need him.
That'd be a poor choice.
Yeah.
Let's show everybody what we can do here at the finals.
We can take OG without her.
Oh, jeez.
Well, they might, just because the Yapzur plays Night Stalker a lot for them. But yeah, with them having two players who can switch between the Night Stalker, I really think the Enigma Darkseer combination should be, you know, respected then. And OG are thinking a lot about what they want to ban here, so.
They removed the Tinker previous game in the second ban phase as well. It's one of those heroes that if you want to go high ground, he's the one that can really drag it out and can really force out those mistakes. So
Koikwa plays it really well.
Yes,
as well.
He does.
He used to play a ton of Tinker back
in the time TI4 when he was in Team Tinker.
It was back when Excalibur was playing as well with Fnatic.
And he was in Team Tinker.
Tinker was just
Interesting. They're gonna ban out Naga. Was Naga that much of a threat last game?
Maybe they
Darkseer Naga is just a classic combo.
All right.
Maybe they're like, okay, they need one game to learn the combo. Now we're not going to give it to them. Because they did not execute it properly.
They did not.
I feel that OG don't really have to worry about the Naga combo, I think, because they have good positioning most of the fights.
Right.
But now, removing the Naga, they can go more aggressively and just dive in.
Yeah.
So they don't have to stay spread out and careful.
And they don't have to back off, they don't have to play it as safe as they did previously.
Yeah,
game.
And we did see them all die, you know, as they were trying to run away in one of these fights.
Okay.
So it just allows them to be...
Oh, talking about that, Disruptor is still in the pool. And we saw that picked up in this phase last game by Nodigity, and it did work out decently, especially when they were defending their high ground. Are we going to see that again this game? Because that would mean that there's no Enigma. You have to then settle for that.
Mm-hmm. Well, we might see it. I just... I don't know. I don't think you need it when you have Night Stalker. Like, we talked about the silences to counter a Phoenix. It really didn't counter a Phoenix at all, by the way, in last game. Fly's positioning was impeccable.
Yeah.
But I think if you already have Night Stalker, which is an 8-second duration silence, you just can play around that.
You're fine with that, okay.
I mean, it depends, though. Night Stalker does so much vision, too, which is amazing with Glimpse. I mean,
that's true.
Yeah, so Dazzle.
Revealing that Moon will play the Doom.
Yep. Moon, Doom.
And Fly, Dazzle. Who would have thought?
Dazzle.
It's an interesting grab. I mean, we generally don't see too much Dazzle recently, unless, you know, battling against some of these heavy minus armor lineups when like Slardar starts coming into play and stuff, but
yeah, since the Winter Wyvern Dazzle days, we haven't really seen that much of it, but he's still very effective. And as you say, the like Slardar is a great option to bring with this as well. Evil hero.
Yeah. Your dire side, you know, being able to manipulate the armor could be beneficial when working around the Roche bit also pretty often, or maybe it will be working nicely in tandem with a later pick.
Yeah.
We'll have to see. But no Diggity's third pick up here. Is this where they got
The Disruptor, yeah.
Okay, yeah. We'll see. I mean, that, or they might have to go for a mid-hero. They banned out the Tinker, and one of the things we were talking about, like, while the game was still going on, and was,
my boy Rasta.
Okay.
Rasta!
Okay.
So...
That's... Okay. I haven't actually seen them play,
So going for, though...
Rasta in a long while.
Yeah, a Rasta over a Lion, where you have two great heroes, great lockdown capabilities, but the difference is one provides the burst and one provides the push.
Yeah.
So I wonder if they're going to be building around this now moving forward, because the other two, Darkseer, Nightstalker, don't add a whole lot of push emphasis, maybe a little bit of Iron Shell, but I'm curious to see if they're going to ramp it up the next two picks, but...
Well...
Gotta like it now.
That's interesting. Isn't Xiao Xiao pretty good against Lycan? I mean, he's got an incredible amount of lockdown for the ult.
Yeah, but either he turns him into a super fast chicken or he shackles him.
It's only shackled.
And if you're standing there shackling, there is a Doom that can interrupt you. There is a Earth Spirit that can interrupt you from very long range. And you have no wolves.
Like,
you're very squishy as a Xiao Xiao.
And don't forget, the Rasta wards are changed. They don't have HP anymore. They have number of hits required, and creeps count as a hit.
Right.
So the creeps have the same amount, meaning the wolves can very quickly deal damage to that too. I don't like Rasta against Lycan, but, you know, Lycan was picked after. Mm-hmm. So, Dazzle Lycan here. A lot of minus armor.
Yeah.
Painful.
Yeah. And they are on the dire side, so you can expect an early Roshan from them as well.
Boy.
And
another
they have
big ultimate, though.
As well.
No Diggity love to work around these big ultimates, big cooldown ultimates.
They always do, though.
Yeah.
That's the way they draft in pretty much every game.
Come on, baby. Show us something big here, then.
But now they have the setup for Sunstrikes, dude.
Oh!
That's true, they got it.
It's true.
What a life.
If you pick up Shadow Shaman just for the setup of the Sunstrike, I think there's something wrong with you.
That's it, Shiver.
Hey, it's worked before.
Yeah, has it? Really?
No, it's most the hero that you pick up to do the Sunstrike solely is Shadow Demon. That is the one.
I love Shadow Demon. I feel like he's undervalued. That's my opinion.
We talked about Centaur for OG.
Yeah. No Diggity taking a page out of their book.
Why is Centaur good here? Tell me.
Well, he's he's going to work well with the Darkseer.
Okay.
I think the two of them... Also, I just wonder how they want to lane this now, though, because they already had a natural pairing in their Darkseer and Nightstalker.
Yeah.
So they're going to farm up, they're putting the Centaur solo against Doom, but that's a lane that Moonbeander has played a lot of times, actually.
Yes.
That
and won.
And won. He has dominated Doom as Centaur, and I think he knows the weakness of this lineup
as
well.
This is an era Centaur?
Yeah. It should be.
Okay.
I mean, good thing the Centaur brings is great disengage too with that ultimate. Obviously, if you get nags, it's
pretty good against Lycan.
But yeah, even if you get doomed up, just get the hell out of there real quick. Mm-hmm. You know, it could help disengage just as good as engage.
Yeah, and that's the power. Like, that's something that Era brings to a team of Nodigity. He does bring a lot of heroes that he can play. He's super comfortable on them, but I just wonder, Era, like a carry style Centaur is kind of risky. So they need a really high impact mid hero.
It's a good shot, Cinderin, by the way.
Damage.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Cinderin,
that's how he looks.
Looking good.
Face recognition is.
Yeah. Oh. That's a nice one.
I
wonder if that thing is good for
here.
A face swap. Yeah. Can we ask? We have a Snapchat account here, DH DreamLeague. Now, I have a request. If you can face swap Cinderin and the Shitzel.
Is that its official
is it
name?
That?
I don't know.
Now it is.
Or the Happy Poop.
No poops, a happy poop.
God. Dude, that poop looks absolutely joyful.
Yeah, especially after losing the first game like that. I don't know.
I thought it was just chocolate yogurt this whole time. Oh no.
You're adorable.
It's a Shitzel.
Okay, so there's a lot of strength heroes on the side of Nodigity.
That
kind of
gives the reason also why they banned out the Tinker too.
Oh, yeah. Is it just a solo? Are they going to play a solo mid Centaur? They could do it.
Lone Druid Centaur mid?
Yeah,
Lone Druid mid, maybe. Or
I think it's more likely that Era plays the...
Isn't Quakefa a really good Lone Druid player? I seem to remember that.
I mean, Quakefa is a good hero,
good player
on ton of heroes.
Yeah.
Especially anything that wants to farm.
Fair enough, yeah.
It's that Rammstein music, dude.
Yeah, that is actually... It probably works.
Oh, PL?
I should try that sometime.
That's a crazy pick.
Wow, this is just a crazy draft.
Okay, OG are
bringing
Quakefa out
Lone Druid,
different stuff.
And it is Era Centaur. So this is our draft, guys. Game two. I mean, Dakota, you asked for something different. This is not very orientated on the team fights. Is it enough? Are you going to go for them?
I mean, Centaur is shorter cooldown, right?
Yeah. I agree that this is probably some of the most freshest lineup we've seen from Nodigity so far.
Fresh.
But to be able to still... I don't know, I'm still going to side with OG. I mean, it's something new from Nodigity. I would question, though, their experience with running this kind of different lineup. So I just think OG is more polished and they'll get the win.
Yeah, I'm ready to just straight up agree with you. I think OG are going to pull this game. And I'm just curious to see how they're going to play the PL Lycan together. It's an interesting pairing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No Diggity either knows exactly what they're doing or has absolutely no idea. I'm going to go with absolutely know what they're doing. I'm going to say No Diggity even though they're probably going to lose. I just like Shadow Shaman. Woo!
I really like Shadow Shaman as well. And I really hope No Diggity can pull out a win here so that we go to game three. But unfortunately,
with me.
I feel like... I'm not sure. I just don't see it happen this game. We're going to find out if it is going to happen this game. Time for game two of the series with Odie Pixel and Draskal.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the casting desk. I'm Odie Pixel, this is Draskal. We're ready to take you to game two of the first series of the day. It is, of course, OG versus Nodigity. OG, of course, up a game at the moment, and things being switched around a little bit in the draft here for game two, as they were saying, indeed, that the Centaur War Runner come out, which we did see a few teams start to pick up during Epicenter. I mean, by no means, I'd never played Hero, but certainly not a common one. Why pick it up at this game for Nodigity?
So,
the common thing for Centaur is you always want an opposition that has a little disable, but they have decent mobility and like no hard stun, right? So that's the criteria for when saying, okay, when's a good Centaur
game?
That's true. Because you want to make use of your ultimate in the best way possible, and usually that's either to engage or disengage. If the enemy team has very little lockdown, and this game they have an Earth Spirit Boulder Smash, which I'm going to be honest with you, probably going to be hard to hit on the Stampede because it's really slow projectile now. It means you can either run away from a fight or go into a fight whenever you want. And that is pretty much their form of initiation. So they put on a core role. It's going to be Era playing it. So he's going to get Blink Dagger. You know, he might go back for a hood or something this game because they do have a pretty decent amount of magic damage. Maybe he goes Vanguard. Who knows? You know, the build is always just, I'm going to get a Blink. I'm going to be tanky. I'm going to run at stuff. The other thing, too, the Shadow Shaman that we don't normally see. The thing about this lineup is that OG don't really have a good way of jumping the Shadow Shaman. So a lot of the time, you think last game, Era's playing this Tiny with a Blink Dagger who can go on the back line and pick off the supports.
Yeah.
That's the kind of lineup that a Shadow Shaman is weak against because you have the potential of dying before you get your spells off. But because of the fact that no Diggity have this really tanky front line and OG have almost zero catch except for the Air Spirit, it means that you're going to be able to set up these Mass Serpent Ward pushes. You're going to have a disengage in the Centaur ulti. And assuming a laning phase doesn't go, you know, abysmally for no Diggity, I think it's actually a pretty solid draft. And keep in mind, four melee heroes against Mass Serpent Wards is not good. You want at least like 2 to 3 ranged heroes playing against Shadow Shaman to make sure you can pick those wards down. So think about how OG played last game, a siege-oriented lineup. That's kind of similar to what no Diggity are doing this time. They just have good fight potential, good pushing. The only thing that I think is a little bit questionable is their late game versus the PL and the Lycan. I think they might struggle a bit with that, but their early mid game should be quite strong.
I mean, in that sense, stronger than what they had in game one, you feel? Like, you're preferring this outlook for Diggity compared to
Game one, I think this lineup is probably stronger. But I think the late game for the first game lineup was probably better. But this is all around stronger, in my opinion.
Yeah. See it. Miracle able to grab that banner in on the PL. Kezu, once again on the darks here up top, grabs himself in return. And so this mid lane matchup, this melee on melee, well, for the most part, with the bear, but the dual core, or the dual hero essentially from No Diggity, and the fact that kind of backup are we going to see crit? The D ward is going to get it. Gee, it's Quake for Lone Druid against Miracle PL. Are we going to see a similar story where Miracle does come out on top, or should Quake have a bit of a better chance this game?
I think that this lineup, the Lone Druid versus PL, it's a lane you don't really see too often, but I think with the pool that he got and a poor man's shield, Miracle should be fine. I think it's only going to be once Quake starts getting a couple levels into the bear that Entangle might become a bit of a nuisance, but keep in mind you can always just Doppelganger out of it, so yeah.
Yes.
I think, you know, Quake might walk away from this with a few CS ahead, but I don't think it'll be a huge thing.
I mean, top lane, we're seeing the same old stuff. You know, we talked about the differences of the draws, but this is being kept the same. The Yapzor-Kezu combination, punishing Moon, and this time a little bit of a different way that the lane is going head-to-head with it. I mean, Moon's got to be careful. There's two Iron Shells out. He is tanky. I mean, he's just tanking up. The Kezu's tanking a lot of these tower hits. Crit's coming in with the rotation, and Kezu, oh, he's got the Surge. He's out. Well, there's your first blood. Yapzor will take it. Crit, can he find the kill in return? He will. So it'll be a one-for-one trade there. The pressure being put on from No Diggity. They get themselves first blood. But is this going to continue to work out up here? I mean, bottom lane. Let's have a look and see if this kill works out. Shackle into Stormer with a double edge. There's enough burst. Diggity find themselves a second. As it ends 2-1 at the moment here in these early stages of the laning phase. And this top lane, I mean, is he going to continue to go this way, finding free kills on Doom, or will OG always be able to punish it?
I think that it will become easier for OG to punish as Crit starts to get more levels. But if they get a good diet...
Oh, hello, No Tail. Right. I mean, that's it. Okay. You know, they get the Dazzle, but getting that, the Lycan as well.
Double Edge hurts a lot during the early game, for those of you who didn't know. 250 damage at level 2. Pretty decent nuke.
And then Quaver in a bit of trouble. Crit rolls forward, but the Savage Roar to remove Miracle from the engagement, and it's enough to get himself out. Yeah, this is a strong start for her, and it's interesting to see these lanes that OG is running as well. Is there a reason why? I guess they just didn't want to put the Lycan against that Darkseer and Soaker lane that No-Tail had to deal with in game one. The Lycan a little worse, well, not as well suited to that as a Juggernaut is with his Blade Fury.
Well, there's a couple of other reasons too. I mean, you're definitely right. Moon, I think, is dead again.
Yeah, I mean, this is working out. This time, where's Crit? There's no backup. So
I think,
get away with that
at this point, you probably just jungle. So the reason why I think they go aggro in this case is because they don't want their supports locked down to one lane. Like, they want crit to be able to move around the map without having posted there. They're like in some farm. So because of the fact that if they go safe lane, they're going to have this double Ion Chill, Darkseer, Nightstalker. It means that Notale will constantly be pressured in air.
Bottom, Era gets the stomp off onto two. He's got a backup, but crit. He's got the Border Smash to follow through. Oh, the Shackle! Cinderin! Nearly saving him. He'll still tick out to the Poison Touch, and Cinderin, he may just pay with his life as well. They'll dive the tower here for him, OG. They'll get themselves the kill. And just like that, crushing that bottom lane that was looking to have a pretty good opening as they picked up two early kills.
This is another reason why you want to do this crit lane.
Radiant's
bottom fine.
Ice.
I wasn't even close.
Can he get out of here?
Yeah,
ice. Okay, there we go. Just enough mana.
Yeah, so you can't really do what they just did to a Darkseer Nightstalker lane because it's just way too tanky. But the Shadow Shaman is very punishable in lane because he has low mobility. One of his disables requires him to quite literally stand still in order to channel Shackle. And he obviously is very level dependent too. So by having this lane down here, you know, you're pressuring the Centauri. He's going to get his blink at a later timing. You're stopping, you know, Cinderin from getting pulls off, not getting free EXP. And sure, Moon's died twice, but the fact of the matter is he's a Doom. So he's going to get his gold. He's going to be able to use his like ultimate in teamfights pretty much no matter what. I think this is a hero that you can kind of sacrifice in a lot of ways and still manage to get some impact from it.
I mean, I feel like already we're seeing that this draft in game 2 particularly, they are having a better start than in game 1.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously the kills, it's 4 for 3. They had the leading kills in game 1, but the CS wasn't quite there. But this time around, both seem to be favoring them. Just a little bit at the moment. And just the potency of this lineup, as you said, if Eric can get that space, get that Blink Dagger timing, suddenly they can start to make the plays happen across the map, just creating space for Quake for them to transition into that later game, getting that good timing with the Midas Radiance on the bet. Crit, he's going to miss a lead in there with the roll. But this is going to have Diggity in pretty good spirits at the moment going into game 2.
And they're going to get the tier 1 super early. Not even 5 minutes in and this thing is almost dropping, so that's going to be a really good thing for them. It means that the Nightstalker can start rotating around. It is only the first night phase. He has a TP available and he almost has his urn completed and is near 5. That is so many things going for Yapzor at this stage. And we've seen what this guy can do with a little bit of an advantage on heroes like Enigma and Nightstalker in the past, so looking to see big things out of him this game.
Looks like OG want to try and make something happen maybe down bottom again. Putting the pressure on. They're bringing in crit as well. They do have backup, no Diggity, so it's going to be a hard
ward.
One to dive.
That ward might have just saved them. So it's hard to tell like if they would have anticipated Yapzor's movement without the placement of that ward, but by putting it down, they just automatically know what's going on. They like hold it.
I mean, Chris still hanging around behind the trees.
Hey, he's got crit.
And he does have a lot of backup, but okay. Fly, silenced up, beautiful crippling fear from Yapzor there to secure that. Make sure the save isn't available. And now they're looking to chase down more, and they may just be able to do it. Double Iron Shells are there. Tiki Pruitt has got a grave this time, though. Get it down, Tom onto No-Tail Era. With the stomp onto Moon, they'll take down the Doom instead. Yapzor, he's looking for it.
He's looking
for it. Can he find it, though? Oh, no, he's gone a little bit too deep here on this one, and they'll punish him. I mean, Seth, you got to give him a 10 out of 10 for trying, though.
All right, that's a 3-kill Dazzle. You don't see that too often. I don't know, I think they maybe put a little bit too much pressure on themselves to make something happen. And just giving away maybe too much when they could have been satisfied with just getting the one kill again on the Doom.
Yeah.
You know, stopping No-Tail from getting farmed. Because regardless of whether or not he dies there, he still has to go back to base. It's not like he's going to be able to just go back hitting creeps with 10% HP when there's a Nightstalker around, so just getting a little bit too big for their britches there and they get punished a bit.
And it really is, at the moment, the battle of the mid laners. You know, you're seeing Koifa and Miracle giving it some, and this time around, the lane's gone a lot better for Koifa than compared to game 1.
I'm surprised that Miracle is, like, this close, though. I guess the matchup is more even than I originally anticipated. Like, I thought it was maybe, like, 60-40 for Lone Druid, but Miracle?
Miracle! He needed that Boulder Smash. He certainly did without that. I mean, he did have crit and fly around. Miracle. He needs to be careful, as we saw that, you know, Yapzor getting a crippling fair into the burst and then Quaifa's beatdown. Yeah, you can kill the PL at this stage of the game, but OG, of course, with crit and fly on the support, they're very good at being in the right place at the right time, and that was another situation where that was the case.
That was really scary for Miracle, because he didn't know that Yapzor was in the area, so he just eats the entangle. He thinks, I'm not in any immediate danger. Then Yapzor comes in out of the fog.
Hello. for it. Playing with this one, Yapzor. Gonna chase it down with the punches. He's actually been trapped in the trees here. No tail turning up as well. Yapzor's got to run, and he's actually gonna take down. Upon themselves, one kill. Crit. He's gonna get himself out. Kezzy dropped the wall for this as well. It's not gonna find anything. Looks like Kezzy will be lucky enough to get away with his life, though, at the least bottom lane. Error. And Sidorin trying to move in onto Fly. Can't quite get the shackles off. So Fly will be fine. Kezzy, he's just trying to beat down on the walls. He's got eyes onto No Tail. And neither of them in a position to be able to take down the other. And it's going to be a TP into the mid lane from Yapzor, but it's back to night time. So we're going to see the pace of the game slow down a bit, potentially, for No Diggity, as they just continue to farm up on the cores. Sidorin is about to hit that level 6, so he's still getting a fair bit of XP on the Shaman, and that should guarantee some free towers across the map once they start to push.
Yeah, that's one thing, too, that we kind of haven't hit on too much, is the Shadow Shaman's timing. It's a little bit later than what you would see from, like, a Dragonite. Obviously, you can see goes mid, but once he hits it, again, it's four melee heroes in OG, so they're going to have to put up a formidable defense to even just get rid of the Mass Serpent wards in the first place. Because if that ranged hero is to hit them, you don't really want to commit to the melee range engagement when you're playing against like Centaur with Stampede.
Yeah, so this could be a very nice spot to kick stuff off the OG, wrapping around the map. They can get a lead onto Koifu. He's already had a lot of space on the mid lane. If they can try and get the kill onto the Lone Druid, but it's going to be hard. Yapzor's there with a backup. Too many TPs come through. They know he's hiding the tree line. There we have it. With the weeds, get the vision straight in onto Lone Druid. Is there going to be any save for this man? No, he's doomed up. He needs a lot of trouble. They'll beat the Stampede, trying to get him out, but it's not enough. They'll lose Koifu. OG there with the successful smoke.
That Stampede was really late, actually. Radiant middle tower is under attack. I think if they had it, like if Koifu had called for the Stampede when the Weave was cast, he probably would have been able to get away. But I guess at the end, they end up gonna trading what offlane tier 1 for mid tier 1. So OG gonna be pretty happy with that exchange. And the other thing too is they don't have to put themselves in a situation where they have to fight into wards.
Yeah.
Because that's like the worst thing for OG to do, is to have to fight into wards at this point.
Yeah, and we can see just those little plays suddenly start to offset the cause. You know, you look at Miracle, you look at Koifu. Now, thanks to that play, Miracle's 1k ahead.
Yeah.
So, bit of a painful loss there for No Diggity in the mid lane, but still, all is not lost. It's 6-for-6. They are finding the tower trades. Era getting the space. That Vanguard build, and almost unexpected to see the Blink Dagger come up next, but took a bit of a way to go on the Sentinel for the Blink to come out.
Yeah, I think they're more basing the lineup around the Siege than they are necessarily going for a pick and push kind of style.
Okay.
Because if the Centaur gets, you know, Pipe, Crimson, whatever, just goes.
I mean, I was going to say, do you think that's going to be the case? Yeah.
He'll probably still get Blink.
Yeah.
But he might get one more defensive item before that. Because just being able to walk into the tower, tank a few shots, get the wards down, deal damage to the building, you can treat it like any kind of Dragon Knight lineup where your main goal is to siege the tower, not necessarily start a fight. And if you do need to start a fight, Stampede with a Night Stalker is probably enough to be able to do that anyway.
Koifu, I want to play a bit careful now because he is very close to having that Midas recipe. It's not going to be the quickest this game after that kill. 11 minutes in. And he does need it to try and keep on par with Miracle's farm on this PL. And OG, Era just keep the ball rolling. They found Era immediately reacted with the Stampede. Is it going to be enough? Got the weave down onto it, and they're looking to move in at the same time on the bottom. Crit's closing in as well, so OG, they want to dive this. They want to move in, and they want to move in hard. Yapzor is going to go for the TP out. Have they got any kind of counter? They haven't. The two TPs are successful. Really nice disengage there from Diggity. And that, I mean, we kind of talked about it in the draft, but that's going to be one of the weaknesses of a lineup like OG. You are going to have that chance to get yourself away, TP out, and OG literally can't really do anything without Crit there and having the Boulder Smashes on point.
Yeah, I think the only kind of mistake that was made here so far is maybe Sindarin dropping wards in the tier 1. So okay. OG are committing a ton of heroes to bottom lane.
Yeah.
They have to trade in this situation, but because of the fact that they use the wards, it means that going tier 2, OG will definitely be able to defend. But I think they would have traded the tower regardless. Like, if you don't drop wards here, I think OG still go for the tier 1, and if you save the wards for the tier 2, then OG actually lose 2 towers instead of 1. So I think the commitment from Sindarin was maybe a little bit too, not necessarily panicky, but he did it maybe without thinking it through 100%. Because I think if he just drops him on this tower, then No Diggity walk away with the win. Instead, they're going to walk away with the trade. Radiant's bottom tower
has fallen. OG, after that kind of trade of events, they're going to continue to push. We have a little bit of port. Okay.
Got a little bit of Kali going on here.
No, Tell at the lag. Sind was fine. Now Sind's not fine.
Yeah, but this situation is, for no Diggity, it's not necessarily great. Because I think that by this stage in the game, you want to have OG kind of fearing the team fight. And I guess, you know, in some ways they are. They're not trying to fight head on unless, you know, OG feel like they're outnumbering no Diggity. And even when they went for the three-man smoke, the Stampede managed to avoid it. So
yes,
it's shown yes. that it has the utility that they got it for. But we have yet to really see any kind of like decisive engagement. We don't know if no Diggity are going to be trying to go for the rest of the towers, or just do they want a siege? Because I think that they are on a bit of a timer here. It's a little bit laid back comparative to the first game. They can probably take it to like 40 minutes, 45 minutes, and still have an okay shot at winning the game. But it is very predicated on this aspect of controlling the game and making sure that all your Mass Servant Ward usages are on point. You know, it's like picking a Warlock. You drop a bad Chaotic Offering, the hero is just useless for 3 minutes. So it's kind of the same thing with the Shadow Shaman, just not as long of a cooldown.
Well, Miracle actually kind of jumping forward there. They'll put the Weave down. Diggity, can they hold this one back? Gera's there. Are the Prince Stampede available? Diggity, I mean, do they really want to try and fight without the armor? As they are lacking a fair bit thanks to Weave, they'll most certainly want to wait for that to come off, and they're not even going to be able to hold it until No Tail finishes off the tower. They'll find themselves that one. Quite but going for the push up top. Miracle will respawn. Holding back Lone Druid. But I mean, it really feels at this point, as you keep saying, I mean, we keep saying a lot, but the Stampede, it's all about the Stampede. And to the point where I wonder, you know, how early on in the build will we see an Agnes come out on Centaur? Because then at that point, it feels like as long as you're able to cast Stampede, you're saving your teammates from any kind of gank.
Yeah, that can be true for sure, but I don't know if Agnes is an item for him this game.
Okay.
Just because when you buy Agnes, I think you really want it for the being able to live through a burst. So say there's like a Skywrath Mage or a Lion or a Lina on the other team. You want to pop it to make sure that those heroes can't get the damage in before you can get your opening, right? Because if you get the opening with the Centaur Stomp and then you get a double edge off with the Stampede, that means that no matter what they do, you're not going to be taking any damage. But if you're playing against this kind of lineup of OG that pretty much only does damage over time, the only person who can really front load burst you is what, the Lycan, and that really relies on him critting you. So without that kind of burst threat, I think that Era probably just sticks to like the Blink Dagger.
Yeah.
You know, maybe he eventually goes back for the Crimson. Somebody might pick up a pipe just because they're up against an Earth Spirit and it's just like a really
I mean, what's Kezu going? I mean, I guess that's the question. What the Dark Souls going for on top of it.
He usually goes mech directly into Blink.
Okay, and then gets the Grease.
Yeah, I think that in this game, he'll probably just get Blink because there's so many melee heroes. Like getting a big vacuum is going to be so easy for him.
And especially if he gets the Blink at a similar time that Eren gets the Blink.
Yeah, exactly.
Then you've got the combo.
Yeah.
Which is going to be absolutely devastating. Vacuum into Stomp, Double Edge, and Wall. That really is going to rip through the lineup of OG at this point in the game.
Yeah, I do feel that OG have a bit of a disadvantage here. But the longer they're able to hold on, the easier it will be for them to transition into that later game. And having the PL to fall back on is always going to be nice. Miracle, interestingly enough, he actually opts for a Vitality Booster.
I do like that as well, especially as we're talking about with these blinks coming online. You need something to survive that burst, also something to survive what Yapzor catching you out with a Night Stalker. There's a chance you're going to be able to live through the silence and then get out. This is super reactive to the way that the No Diggity are playing, and it really could pay off from this game.
I think that it's also nicer too because the damage block now works on
Vanguard and Poor Man's. That's a Pog Champ handy.
Yeah, but you can just sell the Poor Man.
That's true. I'm sure we'll see that guy.
It's not really an issue. I think he just wanted an item that gave him some form of health during the engagements. Because if you buy drums don't give you as much defensively. And I also think it's generally worse for a carry like PL to buy drums because the stat efficiency isn't quite there anymore. So you get like this regen and then, okay, a little bit of movement speed, but whatever. Whereas Vanguard still transitions into an item that offers a lot against a team that will be doing a lot of auto attack damage. And you can build into, you know, whatever you want after, whether it be just straight into Diffusal, if he wants to go for the Manta style first to remove the silence, although Diffusal pretty much does the same thing. But looks like we're just having a tiny bit of packet loss issues here. Hopefully all that's going to be resolved.
Yeah, I said we were fine. First game, didn't have a single pause, so it should be just temperamental. Get ourselves back in there. Smoke actually from Yapzor on Sin. They do have the ward, so I just seen that where they can find. Of course, it would be worth dropping the wards if it means you can get a kill on Miracle. We can see if they can find the opening, but Miracle, which way is he going to go? Actually, he doesn't really want to go this way, because this way, walking into Yapzor, they go, this could be a good chance for Diggity. There we go, lead in, stacking the Hex of the Silence, and indeed, they'll drop the wards, they'll try and go for it, but Fly is there with the Grave, so they're not going to be able to find the kill on Miracle. In fact, he just double-ganges forward, and Sin, oh, he's been doomed. They've doomed the Shaman, and Sin, he's out. I mean, that is the problem there. They felt that they found the perfect opening, but again, you're doing it against OG, you're doing it against Fly, and Fly, he's always going to be there with the Graves. And yeah. I mean, we even saw that. They didn't even need the Graves.
That was a
so
disaster,
much help.
Because it could just be Roshan, honestly, yeah. I think, for OG if they want it. Because they have the Vlads and the Lycan already. Moon's got drums. He doesn't have the Wolf Aura, but with a sustain, they could do it. I guess they're more concerned about the impending push of Lone Druid here in this top lane.
I know the crit's up there, but did you just ping it? I mean, yep, so tell him what's got. Yeah, look, they send the bear and they found him. If they get a good route here, this should be a potential for a kill. Actually saying that, looks like Crit's gonna be able to live for it. It's not quite enough damage. Yabzor smashed up immediately. The TP in front of the Earth Spirit, not gonna work out here for the boy. And he's gonna run. He's tanky, but with the tab being down onto him, Yabzor, can he actually get himself away? Another smash from Crit. He'll set it up. It's the takedown, the Night Stalker error. He stands up. Not gonna be able to jump back in for anything. As OG, as you said, just finding the space for Roshan. And just those last couple of events, starting to feel like OG getting that power swing that they need. And if they get away with this Aegis, it's certainly going to be evident.
Yeah, this... okay.
Oh. Why not? Right.
Stops the Roshan.
Yeah, no tails out. Kezu doing it this game. We saw him try for that last time. It was not successful. Fly getting bursted as well as Era reveals the blink, jumps in and takes him down. Miracle, I mean, he would have an invis rune, wouldn't he? He would. He's actually going to be fine here by the looks of it.
And this whole time, you know, Quaker was just pushing that top here too.
Yeah. This is exactly what they needed. You know, this was about to be the point where OG get the Aegis, you know, get the game and the plan fully set in motion. But no Diggity, yeah, without just that little play, Kezu jumping in, stopping them from getting the Roche. We'll have a pause, we'll see. And we don't have detection. Is it? No, Kezu doesn't have any detection. Sin certainly doesn't. It's Sindarin.
Yeah. I mean, he can barely afford detection. Although he does have 1100 gold, I wonder if he's just going for blink. I mean, does he... Okay, so theoretically, if you were to not buy blink this game and you were just to go for like a Ghost Scepter for Miracle and the Lycan, or you go for a point booster instead, you just try to go for Ags, I feel like that's maybe a bit more conducive to what their playstyle needs to be.
Okay.
Because they are pretty much banking everything on their five men. Now sure, getting a pick into push sounds good on paper, but if you're going for this lineup where you have Vanguard Centaur, you have this really tanky frontline, you have a Lone Druid Bear, why not just play it like any normal five-man draft where it's not really about the initiation so much as it is just getting to the siege? You know, getting to that point where you can drop your wards and actually forcing them to react to you. Because I do think that Nodiggity pushed just about as fast, maybe a tiny bit faster with wards than what OG can do right now. Of course, as the game goes later, that's going to change.
Yeah.
But at least if you give yourself that opportunity to get a little bit more efficiency out of your Shadow Shaman and don't necessarily bank on finding a pick, then it could work out.
And Miracle wants to find some here. Chris joined in. They're rolling onto Sin in a bit of trouble. The Magnetize coming out as well. No escape for Shaman. OG with a quick one. Reset their dominance. And Roshan is still there. I mean, with one hero down, OG may as well just go. At least think about going back in, and they will. They're going to lead back into the Roche. Can they do anything without that? Well, you know, they've got the Plath Leader Zora, so the damage is going to be there. Question is, could Diggity stop this without Sindarin on a Shaman, without those Serpent wards? It's starting to fall at a pretty excessive rate. Are they going to try for anything? Oh, okay, they are. Kezu going in, but it's gone. Look at the Aegis as well, and now OG, they're going to look for kills off the back of it. Get the smash up onto Kezu. Doom, oh, he's got it, and he'll drop it. Straight up to Kezu. There's the Stampede to react, and that's the power, of course, having the center against the Doom lineup, but still, there's an Earth Spirit in the game. His crit gets the smash off onto two. Kezu's gonna fall. And they take down Yabzor as well. Miracle's joining in, and crit rolling forward, trying to look for the block off. Actually gonna respond here with the burst and the double edge. They'll take down crit. Shackle onto No Tail Sin. He might just be doing it here with a comeback through, but it's not enough to contain No Tail for long enough. And he does still have that Aegis. But at the same time, Quaker. He's taking about two-thirds of the tower's health on the tier 3 at the top lane. Miracle will be able to TP out Era. He's not going to be able to chase down the Lycan. But a little bit of a mess. But no Diggity able to punish OG again. And Quaker is getting a lot of space on this Lone Druid.
Yeah, he really is. I mean, he's going to have his Radiance in what? 200 gold, give or take?
And about 60 gold.
Oh yeah, he just Midas, so yeah, he's got it even faster than that. So, all things considered, you normally look at this lineup of Nodiggity and you say, okay, Sindarin's dropping his wards defensively. That's normally a bad thing, right? Like, you don't want to drop your wards defensively. You always want to be trying to get some objective out of it. But if you don't get an objective in this case, it's fine because Quake was already somewhere else on the map counter-pressuring. So instead of dropping wards and not getting any damage on a tower, Quake has almost killed the freaking tier 3 top lane. So all in all, the trade probably okay, especially considering they actually got a kill on crit before OG ended up retreating. If they had gotten Aegis as well, I would say that Nodiggity almost flat out just win that, because getting base damage is super important for their lineup.
But as you said, this is... I mean, it's looking so much better for Diggity here in game 2. I don't know what it is. Is it the way that they played it, or is it, again, as you said,
I think
at the start of the draft? Just as a much, much better suited draft to playing against the playstyle OG like to bring in. That's exactly what you said, you know, after that he did go for the blink, but now he's got the Crimson Guard. This is very scary for OG to fight into, especially if no Diggity the ones getting the jump on you.
Yeah, Lycan's not going to do much against Crimson. If the Crimson is active, you don't...
Oh, if they get Miracle here. If this is... Where's Fly? Fly, we need you back here. He's too far. Oh no. Losing the PL like that, and Diggity, they might even find more. No tell. Let's go for the TP out. He will make it. They're all going to bail just in time. They can't get themselves close enough for the void, but that's the thing, you know, getting that big kill onto Miracle.
What the heck? Quickbit has lost his second bear?
What?
He just let his second bear die to creeps. So they don't actually. I mean, they have wards. And I guess Bear is up in like 30 seconds, but by the time the Bear is alive, Miracle will have already respawned naturally.
I'm sure it was intended.
It
was a taunt, Andy. He was like, look at this, I killed my bear.
Well, I mean, he's taunting his own team if that's the case. Because I think you kind of need that thing alive if you want to try to push. So, I mean, they get a really high priority kill, aren't able to really make anything of it. It was a 5-man smoke. Getting one pick, probably not the worst thing that could have happened to OG, considering he's getting closer and closer to the Diffusal Blade up on the PL. Once that comes out in the team fights, it's going to be a nightmare dealing with him now. Because you can deal with like Surge, you can purge Ion Shell, you just chase down the Shadow Shaman, because he is going for the Aghanims. He's not going for mobility. I didn't know for sure if he was going to go for Blink, but he was saving quite a bit of money. He just opted for the Point Booster instead, which I do think is the right call in this game. Because it's all about the Siege, honestly.
Shitzinner at this point just needs to walk in, drop the wards, and walk out.
Yeah, hopefully not be dead by them.
Which
he
should
ideal.
Be able to do. And this is...
And he's level 11 too after that Tome gets there, so... Not too bad.
And Kez has got the money for Greaves as well, so you are going to have Blink Greaves, the Crimson. You know, the tools are coming together for the side, but at the same time, we know the push is strong for OG with this Lycan with Notar having a level 3 Necro. At the same time, Diggity lose a fight. OG going to be able to power down a lane. And the fact that they've got this Diffusal Blade, we have the potential to see these fights where you just have Miracle jumping in, jumping out, picking off the stragglers. And you know, you start to get the momentum in a fight and suddenly the PL is jumping in and killing everyone. You know, everyone's going to die.
Yeah, pretty much. It's going to get quite scary. Although with the Solar Crest, whoever they're focusing, probably going to be a little bit more durable. Man, I don't know about this ward usage again. I mean, yeah, they're going to secure a tower, but... Now, they're going to get punished.
And yeah, so he's going to get killed by the looks of it. They dropped the combo, the magnetize as well. He's gone. The bear... If they kill this bear again, I mean, is the bear still on cooldown? I'd imagine it is. Yeah, another 30 seconds and there's no bear alive. So, a lot of bear abuse going on this game, and it is hurting quite far. I mean, he was top of the net worth, but without the bear, you're going to allow some of the cores of OG to catch up.
That's some serious bear crime going on here. Another 16 seconds is not, like, too bad, I guess. They do end up trading a tower, but I still feel like they could be getting more value out of these wards. I'm not like necessarily trying to rag on Cinderin or anything, but I think there's been two times this game where he's used ultimate suboptimally. Like when you have three members of your team mid and they're hitting the tier 3 tower and it gets down to like 75% health, if you're there, OG have to make some kind of decisive choice. Like, okay, we need to fight into the wards or we need to back and let the tower take damage. Either way, I think you're getting more out of the ward commitment. Because two times in a row now, outside of the push bottom, he's had to use them defensively. Because OG were always running at the Shadow Shaman, which is how you want to play it. You don't want to let the enemy team get to your base when they have an SS, because as soon as those wards go down, fight becomes hard. But I think he's had a couple of opportunities to maybe make more use of it. And it's not like the offlane tier 2 is really that useful for OG anyway.
What, sir? talking about OG, they do want to try and find a player and they've led into Yabzor. They had no tails, Wolf Scout in and out, setting this one through. The Stampede comes out. Is it going to be enough to save Yap? It's not. Again, these rock placements from Crit, keeping the magnetized flowing, and no tail just diving into the base now, looking for Sin in the vacuum, trying to hold it down. It lets you get the root off of the grave. It's going to allow no tail to continue to fight, chasing in on Sin with the grease coming out from Kezu. Is it going to be enough to keep the Laman alive? No. The Shaman's down. No tail. Wolf with the wall. Okay.
Ouch.
And Kezu with the wall there, securing a double kill as OG just have to walk through it on the way out.
That was a little ham.
I mean, no, he was not holding back. I know he had Fly supporting him. And I don't blame him. You know, you got, oh, Courier? Moon and Crit, they've been spotted out here. Miracle's still around. And maybe they can get Era on the back lines, but Koifa, he's going to start beating away. Era is incredibly tanky. He's out of mana, so now the Diffusal Blade doing less damage. Obviously, Era can't really turn this around on his own. He's got, okay, with Crimson and a Solo Crest, and for the back of a Yamsor, he's going to live for this for the time being. Moon, he gets Vacuum back taken down. They're trying to make a go onto Yamsor. Can they even kill the Night Stalk in the evasion for the Solo Crest? He lives! Gets himself out the soul! The Savage Roar pushing OG back. What the hell is going on here? OG are making mistake after mistake, and no Diggity, they're not messing around. They are quick to punish it. They're going to get Crit as well. Fly not even getting the chance to have a shallow grave, and now he's in trouble too.
This is Rex.
This is Rex. What the hell just happened? OG.
This might even be two, actually. They can kill the top tier three, they can drop wards, and they can just dual siege mid at top at the same time. There's nothing Notel can do.
I mean, that was...
All right, they're just going to drop everything. That's fine. Too.
This was...
There's no glyph. Yeah,
this has been a confusing series so far. I mean, it feels like there's been points where either team's just really not been there. They've just fallen apart as a vibe man, and that was almost painful to watch for OG as they lose all the teammates. They lose two of the important racks, and no Diggity, they gain everything. And look at the net worth now on those heroes. I mean, can we have a look at the net worth graph? I don't know if it's going to have kicked in there. There we have it. That's that one fight. My goodness. I mean...
Diving tier 3s when there's still tier 2s alive, and the enemy team is...
And now, I mean, Sindarin's got a 26-minute axe, and this is Sindarin. Yeah.
This might be the most gold he's ever had at 26 minutes in a game.
I'm impressed as well, because this isn't a Bane. You know, Sindarin's actually playing something different, and I do like that.
No, I think Shadow Shaman has a lot of potential. And against a team like OG, who have a tendency to pick very little catch, Shadow Shaman's a great hero against them.
Yeah, because they've seen that this game.
They don't punish it in lane, because they have a tendency to pick a lot of melee, these greedy cores like Doom and Lycan and stuff like that. But if you are just playing with your team as Shadow Shaman and you drop wards, you know, these heroes don't really do that much. So, really nice drafting from Odigity in game number two.
Now, Koifa, he's got an AC. I mean, AC and Aghanim Serpent.
He just fought a Vlad's. He, like, just got Vlad's and now has an AC after one fight in the push.
Oh, man. I mean, OG. They've definitely still got potential to turn it around, but it's so much harder now after that fight. Two racks gone, massive items being picked up by the side of Odigity. They are. I mean, Syndra, he's probably smarter now. I'm sure they all are.
It's a rough road back here for OG if they want to try to pull this one to a 2-0. I am kind of thinking that the only way that happens is if OG takes some kind of fight outside of their base. Because it's a similar scenario to what we had in game one, where OG were up two sets of racks. You can kind of just throw your bodies into the last set and drop your wards and just get damage on the base. And most of the time, since OG don't necessarily have the greatest wave clear, one or two other lanes are going to be pushing simultaneously. So that means the time it takes you to get across the map is just too long. Like, the respawns in Odigity are going to be faster than the time it takes you to actually pressure. So yeah, rough road here for OG. Impressive though from Nodiggity.
Really,
I mean,
is.
Sure they were pretty much just abusing a mistake that OG made, but still you have to execute to punish.
Yeah, and they really abused it. It wasn't like they're like, oh, they messed up, let's get one kill. It's like, no, let's go for more, and they get everyone. Cinderin.
It's fine. Not even close. I mean, this would probably be the stage in the game where you contemplate buying a blink, but he's gonna go for the team play.
Yeah.
He's gonna secure the gem to make sure that, you know, OG stay restricted to their own side of the map. I mean, as it stands right now, what they have one actual ward out, and it's the one that was behind the tier 2 tower when they were sieging mid before they tower dove and kind of got killed. But they're going to be kicking themselves for that one. It's not even really as if OG had to really push the pace. In the current state of the game, they were about even. And like in Doom PL, I think scales pretty damn well into the late game. I think they just took a bit of a needless risk, and no Diggity were there to just be like haymaker right after that opening.
No, they just really underestimated how hard no Diggity could hit back. It certainly seems the case. I know Diggity, they're playing it a little bit safe now. I mean, maybe they want to wait for this. You look towards Yaps, or he has just about got his Aghanims done. So 500 gold in there, and that will be there. And when they got that, and when under the course of night time, if they go for those high ground pushes, it's going to be so much easier for them to safely just push him with the bear, have Sin find the only to jump in, get those wards down. And OG, as you said, they surely want to fight outside of the base, because I mean, I feel that they can fight at the bottom lane of Rax, but at the same time, with those Serpent Wards, there's a very high chance that during that fight, you're going to lose to Rax, whatever happens.
Yeah, that's exactly the issue.
Yeah.
Even if you make Cinder and use wards and you don't win the fight, got a little bit of lag here.
Just a little bit.
So, okay, I'm actually DCing from the game as well, so.
Oh, so am I.
But our observer isn't.
Pudge.
Looks like Frankenstein.
Does he have a very square head?
AM, anti-mage.
Nice, good call.
Alright, we got it.
We got it. Unless it's Juggernaut.
Oh yeah, it could be Jug.
Unless it's Earth Spirit, which it is, and we were wrong both the two times.
Oh, he was green, of course.
Yeah,
it's Earth
of course
it
is. Yeah, we are, and of course, and it's Coddle Guy. We knew, we should have done that. That was our bad, that one.
Coddle Guy hasn't done Coddle yet, which I find a bit offensive.
Right, what's next? Hello, guys. Hello?
They're thinking.
We're getting close to in-game, don't worry.
I feel like our production is just lying to us at this point.
I think so.
Oh! They weren't lying. Okay.
Thank goodness for that.
I actually forgot that real Dota was happening.
We're actually in game 2.
Oh.
Owen, can you please tell me where I am right now?
Well, we're in a game where OG did a big throw in the mid lane. They lost everyone. As we can see, that was exactly what happened at that point where the graph went whoop. And now at the moment,
the point where OG dove,
yes.
No Diggity's base,
yes.
Died.
And they've got a lot of good items now in Diggity. AC, yeah. Vlad, they've got Shiva's Guard now, an air on top of the Crimson Guard, Force, Blink. They are good to go, No Diggity, so we can expect to see them go for some kind of plays. But at the same time, I mean, they could wait for OG to try and do something, and then they'll be able to hit back incredibly hard. And that's also the thing we're waiting for. Yap sort of pick up the Aghanims, which he has got now. OG smoking up, and looking for a movement. Towards the mid lane, they might actually be able to find a good jump here. Let's see how it kicks off. Moon jumps in, drops the Doom onto Cinderous. There's going to be no wards this fight. Crit coming in with the stun. Catches out Cinderous on the sideline. The wall, the vacuum onto 3. They're going to dive into base here potentially. No, OG playing it safer this time. They take the kill on Cinderous, and now they try and get themselves out. Flies had to grave himself it. But this is it's a good fight for OG. And a clean one as well. This time they don't make the mistake of diving behind the tier 3s. They'll keep it cool. Moon. Cheeky Midas, and off he goes. And he'll be fine.
Oh, we lost the Roshan timer. That stinks. Okay, so, I mean, all things considered, given how the last couple of minutes of the game went, I think that it's nice to get Cinderin off the map because he's a very high-value hero as a support, which normally, you lose a support, it's like whatever. But the thing is, with Cinderin dead, their pushing potential actually is very limited. They're really relying on the Serpent Wards to be able to get, you know, structural damage in. And even though OG only have one set of racks left, they realize that they need to be the aggressors. They can't allow No Diggity to make it across the map and actually get their siege set up. Because if they do, the game is pretty much over. Because even if you win that fight, you're still going to take some base damage. And they can't really afford to anymore at this point, since mid and top lane are both completely destroyed as far as racks goes. So, just trying to buy whatever time they can.
Yeah, here's Diggity about to hit back, or at least try too hard. They're moving in, though this is a time, of course, it's not night time, and Yapsod does not have the ult available. Let's see what happens here. Oh, that's nice. They just pinged that out. They moved the Invis Wolf route. They noticed the path was being blocked around that bottom, so they know that they're smoked, and Diggity realized. They're out. So nice little play from No-Tail there. Just checking out the map with the movements.
I mean, it's good that they didn't get ganked, but at the same time, how are they going to deal with a siege coming in from No-Diggity in a couple of seconds? I mean, they got Greaves, they got a freshly purchased Shivas up on Era.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's the thing, yeah. The Diggity don't need to sneak around at this point.
No, they really
they
don't.
They don't care either way. It would be nice, but they don't need it.
They're probably waiting out Roshan, honestly. They don't feel the need to necessarily end the game right now. They know that mid and top lane are always going to be this push that's going towards OG's base, to where they always have to address it so they can play the slow roll game and just wait for Roshan to respawn, go for that first. Make OG decide if they want to try to fight for Roshan, potentially take base damage or defend their base, give away Roshan, then fight against six potential heroes of OG. And I can't remember, this would actually be third Roshan, right? I think it would be Cheese.
Yes.
Or at least I would assume it would be
Cheese. Yeah, it should be in this one, yeah.
Alright, so wards are dropped.
Ooh! Vacuum wall onto three. They'll get the kick out onto Gezu. Jumping in on the back lines. Moon gets the Doom onto Era. Gonna try and chase him down with the Purge, but he gets surged away. Era should be fine. And they may be able to re-engage off the back of the end of the Doom, but no, Kezu's gone. They'll jump onto him, and in fact, they're moving in for more. Quiper going down faster as well. Look at him melt! With the weave ticking down on his armor, it's another pickoff for OG, and this time it is No-Diggity making the bad play and having to get themselves well out of that. And as we can see, fights like this, they're going to provide huge swings in gold for the side of OG.
That was a really nice Doom coming in from Moon. If they don't Doom, oh wow, they're going to catch a crit here, just going a little bit too far. But if they Doom anyone else but the Centaur, and since the wards were already dropped, Era becomes pretty much the best possible target to Doom, especially considering the fact that Darkseer now has a Lincoln's. So you get the Doom on him, there's no Stampede, no Shivas, no Blink Initiation. You know, a lot of the farm that you put on this hero is in utility items, and that's the one weakness of Centaur against the Doom, is you have four activated items, none of which can be used while under the effects of the ultimate. So you're basically just, like, deleting, what, like, 14,000 net worth of the hero, pretty much. You're pretty much deleting his entire inventory except for the Tranquil Boots and the gem.
Yeah.
So it's a very, very nice play there for Moon. And plus, the other thing too that you have to keep in mind when playing Shadow Shaman is you really want to try to fight around the wards, but when you're pushing the high ground, you're always placing the wards in an aggressive manner, which means if the enemy team is able to gap close on you and chase you away from your wards, you're at a huge disadvantage because your ultimate is stationary and you can't really, you know, you can't readjust them. They're down. So OG making the proper play when needed.
Oh, Miracle? Any players run out of this?
He tried to man that.
He did try and man that. He certainly did get themselves in. Have they got the lockdown? Have they got the silence? Yes, they have. He's gone. Miracle. Down for 60 seconds now.
I don't think he knew that they had a gem, but at the same time, I'm pretty sure they had that and they were pushing, so maybe he just didn't know who was carrying it. But at the same time, pretty costly mistake here.
Very costly. I mean, 50 seconds down, you've got No-Diggity moving in. They have the Serpent Wards, Aghanim's of course as well. They can just go in and drop it, and there's no PL for this defense.
Yeah, I don't know about this one. They do not have Glyph either, because they used it the last bottom push. So this is going to be the make or break here from OG. Can Moon find that really nice Doom target again, or are they going to preemptively put Lincolns on Era, because they think that would probably be the play if you're going to have them siege the high ground? I mean, yeah, they can break it, but at least you get a little bit of reaction time.
Oh, Moon again, he's trying to do what he does before. He jumps in, looks for the priority in terms of the Doom target, and he gets it out onto Cinder, and this is pretty big for them, but at the same time, Era's moving in, Fly's falling low, he'll get himself out of the side, but still goes down. The Glimmer Gate won't be enough to save him. I mean, in fact, the return damage they're hitting back, and Quipe's just punching through them all. It's a triple kill here for the Lone Druid, and I think this game may well and truly be over as we look to potentially move to a game three here in this first series of the day. It's going to be almost indefinitely mega creeps if the wards can get it done. Syndrome, he's doing his best to hold them off here. But the wards, they're punching down.
Got the Rex.
That looks incredibly funky. And that's the thing, as we talked about, the fight, they force out a buyback. There's three currently dead on OG, but they find the melee Rex, only a ranged Rex left standing. OG, they need to pull out the serious plays to bring this game back.
I think that showcased perfectly what we were talking about when we said,
oh, they missed the Hoostop. And now with the stun from Crit, they may have a chance of turning it. Now the Savage Roars there to force OG back, and Miracle and Crit both incredibly low. Mega Creeps are out, and GG is cool. We're going to a game three. that play in the mid lane for OG really did kind of seal the deal for them this game. And no Diggity, they, as we said, they abused it perfectly. They punished OG so hard. And that huge swing there pretty much got the game to a point where OG just didn't have the lineup really to turn it back around. And we are going to indeed be going to this game free.
And there's a couple of things I think you could attribute this loss to if you're OG. Yeah. I think the draft from No Diggity was quite a bit stronger than it was in game one. I think it had more versatility. Their mid game was stronger, which it seems like